Oh God, this is the day that we step into, daring to look into the Father's cup. This is one of those holiest of all moments when God prayed to God. So we ask you, Lord, come. Reveal the unthinkable to us. Show us, Lord, the Father's cup, the beginnings of it today. And all week long may we step into a deeper, gripping, heart-tearing revelation of the Lamb, primarily when you drank the Father's cup. And Father, I just want to thank you today. I thank you that you opened your heart and poured out your wrath upon your beloved one. Thank you for the incredible love that took on your part, the unbelievable sacrifice on your part. And I repent to you on behalf of the church, which not only has neglected the Father's cup, but is now saying God would never do that to his son. Oh Lord, you've been misrepresented. It's a mockery. It's blasphemy, in my opinion, God. And I repent to you, Father, for the way the church is closing our hearts to the magnitude of what you did. And I ask you to raise up men and women in this room to be revivalists, thunderers of the cross, of the Lamb, of the Father's cup, of the gospel in its purest form. Not a diluted gospel, not a watered down gospel, not a let's take all the depths out of it and make it acceptable. Not a seeker friendly gospel, but a gospel that burns and that transforms, that will burn through the fog that has settled over this land and over the Western church especially, that has denied the depths of the Father's cup. So we ask you to do it today, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. It would mean a lot to me if those of you who are on the sides or in the back could come in here where I could see you. Would y'all do that for me? So we are going to start today. This is where we really start. We've been warming you up, getting you ready these last few days. So come with me now. Let's start by going into the Passion of the Christ video. And just, I want you to just kind of sense and hear and listen to what Jesus. Okay, it's going to take him a minute to do that. So let me take you in. This will help get us ready. This chapter is called Blood in the Garden. That's the name of the class today. On tiptoe with awe, let's follow the Lamb as he leads the disciples out of the city gate and over the brook Kidron. Because it's Passover, the waters, now picture this, the waters run dark with the blood of slain lambs funneled down from the Temple Mount. What an amazing scene this presents as the Lamb of God, whose own blood will run like the crimsoned waters of the brook Kidron, as he crosses over the bloody stream. Come watch him now. Picture him. Watch him now as he climbs the Mount of Olives and enters the Garden of Gethsemane, which means Garden of Crushed Olives. Here in this garden, the air hangs still, cool and crisp on this late night in spring. A full Passover moon casts silvery glints on the olive leaves. Picture yourself asleep on the moist ground of the garden. Listen now. Can you hear it? It's a deep moaning sound, like an animal howling, a loud, masculine sob. Father! It's Jesus praying with loud crying and tears, it says in Hebrews 5:7. It seems that he is overcome with torment. to his three disciples, he says with deep emotion, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Crawl up closer and look. The sight will knock the wind from your lungs. In the bright light of the full Passover moon, you'll see his body bathed in sweat." No, it's not just sweat. It's blood. "Without whip or thorn or nail to rip through his human flesh. See blood press out through his skin like oil pressed out of an olive. No wonder this is called the Garden of Crushed Olives. Here lies the one who contains the glory of eternity, rolling in the dirt, soaked in his own blood." Now, as we enter the Passion of the Christ, the Garden of Gethsemane scene, it doesn't quite describe it like this, but if you look into the scripture in the Bible, you'll see he was on his face. He was writhing on the ground. He started on his knees. He ended up on his face, Matthew tells us. So let's go now into that scene, the Garden of Gethsemane. The Garden of Crushed Olives.
Sina othia boi. Kuma. Pezrati. Shapreni me reshetar she. Tomanu elai.
Engahel, kastige ide mini, a ken lakis fa, lehuwe di lakis fa,
Hold me.
Mintam.
Man ba yin.
نحن باين يشوى من سارت
انا هو
Fible. Kudi je herla krova? Ti krova je bud. Fible.
Malchus was never the same after that. Malchus being the high priest's
servant.
Let's go back to the PowerPoint.
Please.
So, Holy Spirit, open our hearts to understand more deeply what took place in that garden. I pray it will grip our hearts forever. Just ask the Lord to help you see, to help you understand. Open my heart, Lord Jesus. Let me behold the Lamb until my heart is truly pierced. Praise you, Lord. So, we enter now the Garden of Gethsemane. This is called Blood in the Garden. The Garden of Crushed Olives. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And I believe, if you recall the other day, I said to you, in my opinion, there are three of the most holy moments in all eternal history, and I believe this is the second one. And there are other amazingly holy moments. But this one, between God and God, the first one was the covenant of redemption is between God and God. Now, God is praying to God in the Garden of Gethsemane, in this Garden of Crushed Olives, as Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all talk about this. Jesus, Yeshua, when he goes to his disciples, meditate on this word. Meditate on this verse that he says. He said, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Jesus doesn't exaggerate. Think about that. This is the eternal Son who was in the bosom of God, John says in John 1:18. He was in face-to-face fellowship with God the Father through all eternity. And now he is deeply grieved. Why? Because of what he is seeing, what he's going to endure, what he knows is going to happen, what the Father is showing him. In fact, the Greek word here indicates he is horror-stricken. What he sees is so deep. I don't know. It seems to me God hides these things so that he can reveal them to those who will study and go deep and meditate and doesn't take just intellectual study. We're talking about heart study. So we begin to think of and almost feel what he felt. You know, Paul talked about, I fellowship with these sufferings. When we think of how deeply grieved he was, I am overwhelmed by that. When I think of God the Son being deeply grieved, what does that mean? So sorrowful, so broken, so overwhelmed, so filled with pain that he's deeply grieved to the point he's about to die right there in the garden. Some people try to say, well, that was his worst suffering. No, it was not his worst suffering. It was when he, but here in the garden, he is looking into what will be the worst suffering. And so he is almost about to die right here in the garden. Remember, he doesn't exaggerate. Now, Hebrews 5:7 says that he prayed with loud crying and tears. If Jesus is praying with loud crying and tears here in the garden, I mean, it wasn't just like we've seen it, this soft little prayer. But loud crying and tears, wailing, howling, crying out with deep passion before the Father. Well, you would too if you were going to drink the Father's cup. He cries out, Abba, that intimate name of God. Abba, Father, nothing is impossible with you. And then he goes back to his disciples. Now here's my question. How on earth can they sleep through this?
when he is crying out in prayer with loud crying and tears, how do they just sleep? I know they're tired. But brothers and sisters, I want to suggest to you, I know I was sleeping. I was asleep to the Father's cup. I was asleep to the depth of the cross. These disciples were sleeping before the cross. Now we're sleeping after the cross. Everyone was crying out, we need a great awakening. I say, yes, we need an awakening. But it's the Father's cup that I have found. This is not my theory. This is not only something I just experienced. I mean, I did, yes. But I've seen it awaken so many people through the years. And that's why I haven't given up. That's why I've never gotten off this message. I've seen the fruit. Some of you have seen the fruit of this message. So I ask you then, let's crawl up closer and look at him. His body is bathed in blood. Don't discount that. Luke wrote, he said, his sweat became like drops of blood falling, not just dripping down, but falling to the ground in pools beneath him, I'm sure. But how can I say this was great drops? In fact, let me show you this quote by Spurgeon. He said, his not only was his sweat blood, not only did he sweat blood, but it was in great drops. The blood coagulated and formed large masses, gouts, big, heavy drops. It was clotting. He was releasing clots of blood. How can I say that? Because the Greek word for drops is thrombos. Look it up in vines. It means thick, heavy clots of blood. So Spurgeon says all of his garments were covered with clotted blood. Can you imagine that? And I know you'll meet people, Josh, out there and say, oh, it wasn't really blood. It was just like blood. Well, I've got this to say to them. Sweat doesn't clot. When it hits cold air, blood clots, not sweat. It congealed and became great clots or gouts, as Spurgeon says, of blood. People always want to try to undo the depths of the cross. It's amazing. But we're not going to let them, are we? We're going to go forward with boldness. Here he was like a high priest. Remember how the high priest would put blood on the mercy seat? The blood of the lambs on the mercy seat? The blood of the various sacrifices? Well, here's the one who is the high priest. And he's sprinkling out blood. But it's coming from his veins, his own veins. He who is the Lamb of God. But this is the first issue of lamb's blood. Now, oozing out in the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, do you see what God is calling us to come back to the blood? To return to the blood? It's time for the blood of the Lamb. But why does Jesus so dread dying? I mean, you know, I know people speculate as to why he dreaded dying, but it's right there in the scripture, and you already know it because we've been leading up to this. So I ask the question, and you can ask these questions when you go out there to preach. Some of you think you'll never preach. Oh, you just wait. You just wait. You won't be able to contain yourself. You probably will. If you're like me, I'll tell my story today. I didn't know what was going to happen the first time I opened my mouth and talked about the Father's cup. Almost 30 years ago, I had no idea. Because I'd never, ever encountered that kind of passion and brokenness and just love and emotion over the cross. So I'm asking you the question, why was he sweating blood? Why was he crying out in loud crying and tears? Why was he almost about to die? Was it because he had just come from communion and he knew that his body would be broken and his blood would be spilled out? Was it because he knew the priest would beat him and slap him and spit in his face? The religious system would mock him and blaspheme him? Is that what he so dreaded? Or was it, and this is what so many people think, was it because of that horrible scourge with his bits of bone and metal that would rip out great hunks of flesh from his body? This was called the first death for many. In his day, who were beaten like this. But even the other thieves beside him on the cross were not beaten like he was beaten. 39 lashes, and it often killed a man. It often ripped out their eyes from their sockets or disemboweled their body, organs, liver, kidneys, ripped out. And that's why people often died from this terrible scourging that the Romans had developed. It was called the Roman flagellum. Not just a little cat of nine tails, not just leather strands. Oh no, so much more. And that's why when people look at the Passion of the Christ movie and they say, oh, that was just too bloody. Oh my goodness. The movie didn't show it all, but it did a great job on that beating, that scourging, that flagellating. It did. It showed that to great depths, I believe. So was that what he most dreaded? No. It was so much more. Was it the heavy weight of carrying the cross, the patibulum, over his shoulders as he drug it, bleeding from every wound, drug it through the streets of Jerusalem? Is that why he was so sweating blood there in the garden as the Father was showing him all of this? Was it because his own mother would be weeping at the foot of the cross as she looked up at her son, bleeding and dying right before her own eyes? Is this what he so dreaded? Well, I think all of this plays together as to what he was dreading, but it was more. Could it have been the spikes in his hands? The spikes in his hands. You notice I didn't say wrists. I know it's true, and people always like to make an issue of this, that they did crucify people in his day through the wrists. I personally believe it was through the hands. You can't prove it by the Greek, because the same Greek word means hands or wrists, so it could have been either. But I truly believe it was his hands, because these are the hands that healed. These are the hands that still heal. These are the hands that are opened up to now release glory down upon his people, healing glory. And so I believe it was his hands that were spiked to the cross. And you say, yeah, but the argument is it would rip his through the hands. Oh, but ropes held him. Ropes held him there. That's why it didn't rip through his hands. And so it was not just hands that were spiked, but it was his feet that were spiked there on the cross. And you can preach a whole sermon on just the spiking of his feet and the spiking of his hands. But it was so much more that he saw there in the Garden of Gethsemane. Or was it the Jewish people that he loved? He said, I came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And so many of them rejected him. Even his own disciples rejected him. But was that what he so dreaded and was sweating blood over there in right there in the Garden of Gethsemane? Was it because there on the cross the darkness of human sin would come down upon him? Yes, but more. So much more. Was it because Satan would torment him? Oh, you think you're the Son of God? You're never going to rise from the dead. You're going to die. It's done. You lost. You're a failure. You came into this earth and you failed in your mission. All the things that Satan would have tormented him with there on the cross. Was that what it was? Or was it because God Almighty, his beloved Father, would remove his presence from him to the point that he would cry out, why have you forsaken me? Is that what it was? Oh, it was all of these, but it was so much more. You see, people look, I mean, I've had people say, well, even the martyrs didn't weep blood, didn't sweat blood. Why was Jesus so fearful? Martyrs went to their death for the sake of Christ in victory. I mean, Andrew himself, one of the disciples, said, I never would have preached the glory of the cross if I had been afraid to die upon the cross. Oh, cross, I have longed to embrace thee. Peter was crucified upside down on a cross. Were they more courageous than Jesus? Did they sweat blood over their death? No. Charles Spurgeon tells a story about a man who was being burned at the stake, and his whole body was charred, just charred to the point that finally his upper torso just fell over. And someone nearby heard him say the last words, oh, sweet Jesus. And then he died. He died with courage. But what was going on with Jesus? Why was he so gripped that he was sweating blood? And there's your answer right there in the very prayer that he prayed in all four Gospels. He prayed. He said, Abba, this is Mark's version. Abba, if you're willing, please remove this cup. The cup. We've been talking about it now for days. So what is this cup? Jonathan Edwards said his principal errand into the world was to drink that cup. His principal reason, his primary reason for coming all the way from eternity into this earth was to drink that cup. But how many times have you ever read a sermon or ever heard a sermon about the Father's cup or read a book or just heard people talk about it? And I've had people come to the camp through the years, and they, even before they even hear, or sometimes they never hear this teaching. They just come on Friday night fires, and they don't come into the internships, so they never get into the depths, or they never read one of the books. And so they're going, what is this cup everyone's talking about? When I was at BRSM, taught there for 5 years, 7 different courses, all the students, I'm telling you, almost 100%, probably 98% of the students, they talked about it every day. They were so gripped by the Father's cup. And they were saying, why didn't anyone ever tell me about this? And see, we know it. We do know it. Those of us who are older, we know about this. But there's so many of the younger ones will say, I never heard about the Father's cup. Why? Because we've never told them. That's why I'm so gripped that we've got to raise up ministers of the cross, the full gospel, the Father's cup. Because it will change everything. So what is that cup? Well, the Bible interprets the Bible. First, I want to look at the fact that at the Lord's Supper, the Passover meal, the disciples, before Jesus went to the cross. And this is just a simple truth that's in the Passover meal. There were 4 cups on the table. And the first cup spoke of holiness. It was the cup of Kodesh, the holiness, preparing them for the entire supper. I'm not going in the depths of the Lord's Supper. I'm just pointing out the cups. The second cup, it was called the cup of trembling. It was called the cup of judgment. It spoke of, in fact, often in Passover Seders, they'll take, people will dip their finger into the second cup and drop 10 drops into a little platter and then drink from that. It's called also the cup of iniquity. Jesus looked into that second cup. And I think his heart trembled. But he reached over and he picked up the cup, the third cup. It's called the cup of redemption. And he said, this is the new covenant in my blood. Drink from this, all of you. But he knew they could not receive the redemption. We could not receive redemption until Jesus had fully drunk to the dregs the cup of judgment. It spoke originally of the judgment that came upon Egypt. It spoke of the judgment of God. It spoke of the wrath of Almighty God. And Jesus knew he had to drink that cup. And the final cup was called the cup of the kingdom, the cup of Elijah. And this is the cup that he said, I won't drink this cup until I drink it with you in the kingdom. And so here we are. And I'm asking you, why was Jesus in such torment? So I wanted to show you that from the Passover meal, but I also want to look at a few. If you'll read the Undone book, you'll see a lot more scriptures. But I wanted to show you a few of the scriptures from the Old Testament, the Tanakh, as Jewish people call it. It says in Isaiah 51:22, see, I have taken from your hand the cup that made you stagger, the goblet of my wrath. I don't know if you noticed, but in the Passion of the Christ movie, it was just called a goblet. But the Bible, the Old Testament, calls it the goblet of my wrath. You've got to stop and think about that. You know, we've had the head knowledge, but our hearts have to be touched by this. It says in Jeremiah 25:15, take from my hand this cup that is filled with the wine of my wrath. Think about this. Wrath. God's eternal wrath. It's almost too much to comprehend. We have to try to meditate on it. That's one of God's attributes. It's eternal. It goes on and on and on. It never ends. But it's all now condensed in this cup. Parts of it would come on people in the Old Testament, but nothing like what all that would be condensed together in this cup of God's wrath that Jesus would drink on the cup, on the cross. Do you see why he was praying and sweating blood? That's why it says in Isaiah 53:5, we considered him stricken by God. I used to read it like this. We considered him stricken by God. No, read it like this. We considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, afflicted, and the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. Because that is what happened. Isaiah 53:4-5. And so Jesus lifts up his voice and he finally cries, Abba, Father, everything is possible with you. Take this cup from me. And more, the scripture doesn't show us this, but I feel in this intimate place between God and God, the prayer between God and God, the Father would have whispered to him something like this. Son, don't you remember the covenant we made before the creation of the world? The covenant of redemption, when the Father said, Son, I want a family. I want to give you a bride. But Son, before I can give you this bride, there is a fathomless price you must pay. You must come in human skin. You must allow your flesh to be ripped open. And there on the cross, you must drink my cup. And the Father showed him this before the creation of the world, and the covenant of redemption. That's why he is called the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And I feel like he would have somehow reminded him of that covenant there in the garden. But he's still, it's like he's giving him one more chance. Son, are you still willing to drink this cup? He said yes before the creation of the world, but now this is brought before him again. Jonathan Edwards said the Father did not want his son to go blindfolded to the cross. I mean, blinded in the sense that he didn't know what he was stepping into. He wanted to remind him and show him what this cup entailed, what he would endure. And so Jesus there in the garden sees the wrath of God. He sees what will happen when this wrath roars down upon him. Jonathan Edwards said he sees himself in these Old Testament types, they're called. Tupos means examples in the Old Testament. For example, when Sodom and Gomorrah, they were escaping, but fire and brimstone came down on Sodom and Gomorrah. But that same fire and brimstone will come down on Yeshua, on Jesus, when he drinks the Father's cup. Edward said he saw himself as the burning bush. Wood speaks of humanity. It's the humanity of Christ. But he is blazing. He is burning in the wrath of an eternal God. The lamb. He sees himself as a lamb cast down on the altar and consumed in fire there on the altar of the cross. Jonathan Edwards said he would be cast into the furnace, just as the furnace in the Old Testament showed the three Hebrew boys that were cast into that flame, and there was a fourth man. But God will open up his furnace of wrath and pour him in. And I know some of us look at that and we say, how could God be that cruel? Please, that's not the point. That's not the question. We don't understand God. Do you understand God? God Almighty. I mean, eternity is within the heart of God. God is bigger than eternity. It's hard to wrap our minds around this, but God is holy. It's a holiness like we humans, because of the fall, don't even comprehend. But because God is holy, in order for us to come into his presence, someone had to pay the price of sin. That's what the world doesn't understand, is that Jesus did this out of phenomenal love, out of indescribable love, the Father I mean, honestly, Mary said this the other night, and I so feel the same way. There's nothing that grips me more than the Father's heart for His Son. For what the Father had to do to pour this cup upon His beloved one. If you can imagine as a mother or a father, some of you, to have to pour fire upon your child, like Abraham almost had to do. And you know, God tries to give us little glimpses through the Old Testament. But no picture fully tells the story. And so this furnace of wrath that would open over the Son was not out of cruelty, not out of abuse. It was out of love. That's why we can never fully understand the love of God until we look at the Lamb and we look at the depths of the Father's cup that the Father was willing to pour on His beloved, beloved eternal Son, and that the Son was willing to drink. The wrath of God was in that cup, and that's what God showed. The Father showed His Son, but He sees even more. He sees the punishment of hell burning down upon Him. Our hell was in that cup. For some of you, what? Our hell? What? Listen, this should give you so much hope. And those who don't want to hear about hell, if we can bring it to them in the context of what He did on the cross, whether they receive it or not, it's almost like it's there. It's like a challenge. Will you receive what God did or not? It's like the line of demarcation. It's like the sheep and the goats. Will we receive what God did for us? Our hell was in that cup. You know what it says in Revelation 14:10? It says He would endure, or excuse me, this is a quote from Jonathan Edwards. He would endure the very pangs of hell. The contents of this cup were fully equivalent to the misery of the damned, for it was the wrath of the same God. That's why it says in Revelation 14:10. And this, there's probably no scripture that defines the cup any better than this scripture, Revelation 14:10. But it also shows that Jesus drank the cup, but there is still the cup to pour on those who reject what He did. If they reject what He did for them, the Bible says in Revelation 14:10, He who takes the mark of the beast, that's all those who reject Christ and who follow the way of the world, they will drink of the wine of God's fury, which has been poured full strength into the cup of His wrath, and he will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the Lamb. And when you think about how the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, feel when he sees the very cup that he drank, having to fall on those who rejected what he did for them, that's why this is so serious. I mean, I cannot take this lightly because everything hinges on this. And the Bible, if you believe the Bible, if we believe the Bible, we know this is true. The wine of God's fury, which has been poured full strength into the cup of his wrath, and he will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the Lamb. And I believe it breaks the Lamb's heart when he paid such a price and people reject him. But how much more does it break the Father's heart when he sees people reject him? Charles Spurgeon said, all hell was distilled within that cup. And if you'll read the Undone book, you'll find some of the greatest scholars, and that's not a bad word. These are people who have studied theology, and theology is not a bad word. Theology means, theos means God. Ology means study of. Theology is a study of God. And it hurts me when I hear people mock theology. What they really mean is they're mocking intellectualism. We don't want intellectualism. But sound, solid, biblical theology is what must be restored, especially in the charismatic movement. We've gotten so excited about the latest revelation, and we've missed the revelation of the Lamb, the most important revelation of all. And it's right there in the Scripture. And people want the latest mystery and the greatest. Yeah, but this is the greatest mystery, the mystery of the Father's cup. All hell was distilled within that cup. You want to know why Billy Graham had such a God-blessed ministry through his life? Because he preached the truth of the gospel with his pure, in its purest form. Graham said Jesus' greatest suffering was the spiritual agony he endured as he took upon himself the death and hell that you and I deserve. Yet, by allowing his son to suffering the pangs of death and hell, God demonstrated how much he loves us. Again, can you see this is God's love in its highest and greatest form? But Billy Graham, you know, I heard him say when he turned 70, he was asked on the 700 Club, if you had your life to live over, what would you do differently? Do you have any regrets? You know what he said? He said, my greatest regret is that I didn't study the cross more and preach the cross more. And yet, people mock him now and say, oh, that's just that fundamentalism. You know, if we can put a label on something, we can dismiss it. Don't let them do that to you, Josh. Don't let them take to you the heart and essence of the gospel. And if you question it, go back to the Bible and let the Bible, the Word of God, strengthen you back. Yes, Jesus drank our hell. This is my hell that he drank in my place, in your place. He drank your hell because God is a holy God. Spurgeon said, there was the cup. Hell was in it. The Savior drank it. Not a sip and then a pause, but he drained it until there is not a dregs left for any of his people that love him, that know him. But for those who don't, oh my. But no wonder then that Jesus was sweating blood in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember, we're just talking about what he looked at. We're not actually talking about when the cup came on him. We're talking about what he saw ahead of time. Oh, my heart breaks. Because if only they knew. There's so much suffering. There's so much pain, especially this young generation. Well, the older generation too, because we've been through so much heartaches ourselves. But this young generation have been the fruit of those heartaches. The fatherless generation. And mother pain as well. There's so much suffering. So much shame. So much grief. So much numbness. But if we could tell them what he did for them, he took their hell. So many of them know if they believe in hell at all. They know, well, yeah, I'm going to hell. Yeah, I deserve hell. They know. They know what they've done. Have you, any of you young ones ever felt like, yeah, I deserve hell? Jesus took your hell. Do you realize what great news that is? Don't you just burn to tell your generation what he did for them? See, the cup changes everything. Everything. Once you see that. Those of you who want to minister, who are already ministering, if we could just tell them. And you say, oh, but that's just too much for them. Listen, if they see, you say, oh, I can't preach it with that kind of passion. That's okay. You know what they need to see? They need to see the tears in your eyes, guy. You may, I don't know how passionate you'll preach it, but when those kids see those tears, they see your tears, Lenora, they know how real it is. That's what they're looking for. Isn't that what Dutch Sheet said yesterday? The question of this generation is God real? And you know what? You know, they may say something stupid like, okay, if God's real, that cup will fall off the table. That's not going to change anything. But man, if they see those tears in your eyes and you're preaching about what Jesus did and it's your testimony, that's real. I mean, they can't deny he's real to you. If he's real to you, then maybe he's really real. That's why I pray God will pierce our hearts. So we can bring hope, bring love to a lost and dying generation. So Jesus looked into the Father's cup there in the garden. And I want you to look into that cup. Let me go back to that. At that point, when the Father showed him the cup, finally he lifted his face to heaven and he said, "Not my will, Father, but let your will be done." He didn't want to have to be separated from the Father like that. He didn't want to have to be fully imbued with sin. He didn't want to have to endure wrath and punishment and judgment. He didn't want to. Who would? But he knew he would obey the Father. But there's another reason why he said yes. And this is the one that always stuns my heart. He looked into that cup and he saw something. Look into that cup. Can you see something there? Do you see a person? He looked into that cup and he saw what would happen if he didn't drink it for you. That's what motivated him. He was driven. He was compelled by love. Love for you. He said, "God, whatever it takes, I'll drink that cup." And I always tell this story, but to me it says it so well. It's the story of a house that caught on fire one night and a mother awakened smelling the smoke. She woke up her husband and said, "Honey, the house is on fire, but the baby's upstairs." And she could hear the baby crying. And so she jumped out of bed and began to run up the stairs, but she couldn't get up the stairway because the smoke, the turbulent, the rolling and heaving of the fire and the smoke, it drove her back and she couldn't breathe, and the heat drove her back. And finally her husband grabbed her and pulled her outside and said, "Honey," you know, he wanted to save his wife at least. Well, she's outside in the yard. Now the firemen come. The firefighters come and they begin, you know, hooking up their hoses and trying to get their ladders ready. And all this time she's hearing her baby crying. I want to tell you, God has heard his babies crying. He's heard your children crying. He's heard you crying. There are times that you cried out to God and you thought, "He never heard me. I just fell through the cracks." He doesn't hear my cry because you felt so forsaken by God. But God heard your cry. This mother heard the cry of her baby, and she knew there was a fire up there. And but her husband was holding her back. The firemen were trying to get the ladders up so they could break out the window and go up and save that baby. But she knew time was passing, and she kept hearing the cries of her baby, the screams of her little baby girl. Finally, she broke loose from her husband. She ran into the house. She tore up the stairs. She just decided no matter what it did to her, she was not going to give up. She wrapped her robe around her. She pressed on as the fire was burning her hands and her face and her hair. And she pressed on up into that room upstairs until finally she got to her baby's bed. And she picked up her little baby girl and put her inside her robe. And then she staggered, stumbled, fell down those stairs, burning, consuming, her lungs filled with smoke, and finally made it to the door, tried to turn the handle, but her hand stuck to the handle, and then she finally fell out into the front yard, just a crumpled heap of smoking ashes, in a sense. Her body was taken, and the baby was taken to a burn hospital immediately by a helicopter, and the little baby recovered quickly. She had some smoke but damage in her lungs, but soon she recovered. But the mother, her face had been burned to the bone. Her face was scarred. It was mutilated. And it took, you know, months and months of recovery in the hospital, and then surgery, and then more surgery and more surgery before she was even recognizable. And even then, she was still scarred and mutilated. And she came back home to her family. And the years passed. And the little girl grew up into a beautiful young lady. And her friends would come to the house sometimes. And you know how kids can be, kind of cruel. Sometimes someone would say, "Why is your mother so ugly?" Because she was mutilated. And every time that little girl she would just smile and she'd say, my mother is the most beautiful woman in the whole world because she went through the fire for me. I'm alive. That's what Jesus did for you. He went through the fire for you. And because of that, you're alive. And you'll live forever because he went through the fire for you and drank the Father's cup. You know, I'm not talking about a literal fire, but how much more? I mean, a little literal outward fire. How much more flaming and blazing is the cup of eternal wrath and hell and judgment that he would drink when he goes to the cross tomorrow? He saw what would happen if you didn't drink, if he didn't drink that cup for you. He saw you burning in an everlasting hell. You say, I can't believe that. Do you believe the Bible? You say, oh, maybe, maybe not. Well, do you believe Jesus? Read his words. If you will read the Bible, you will see there are more scriptures spoken by him, verses spoken by him about hell than any place else in the Bible. He described it more than anyone else. It's true. We just have to find a way to tell people about it. But I think, to me, most of all, I wanted to bring it in the context of the hell he already took. And that's why to deny hell is to deny what he did for us. Dear Jesus, help us understand. Well, the disciples didn't understand. And so he goes back to them and he says, why are you sleeping? Covered with clotted blood. Imagine that. Standing there before them, covered with clotted blood. And they slept through the Father's cup. But they didn't know yet. We do. We're on the other side of the cross. 150 years this was preached by Edwards and Spurgeon and all the great Puritan scholars and others. But it's not anymore. We think, oh yes, we're so smart today. No, we've lost something. We've lost the heart of the gospel. We've got to restore it. And that's why God brought you here. So that he could pour it into you and you could take it out. We're not trying to build a big ministry. We're trying to give something away and say, it's yours. You take it now. You know, Judas came up to Jesus right there in the garden. And amazingly, he planted a kiss on the Lamb. The Judas kiss, I call this. What does it mean? It means we say we love him. Outwardly, we love him. We betray him with our lives because we won't live in the holiness he calls for. We continue on in sin. And you know what? Some of us have been talking about this. Oh, I don't want to point a negative finger, but I could put it on myself. I planted a Judas kiss on Jesus because I didn't know about the cup. And I lived the life, and I said the words, but I denied the depths of the cross. Oh, that's baby stuff, I thought. No, there's a world, there's a church out there that needs to hear what he did. And not just, why do you think so many young people are still in sin? They go to church, they name the name of Jesus, but they're still living in sin. You know why? It's just like Mary's mother said to me years ago, my daughter couldn't live, saw no reason to live without sin until she saw the Lamb. And when she saw the Lamb, she was on her face weeping. It started when she saw the tears in Steve Hill's eyes and she realized God is real. And she gave her heart to Jesus. And then I would watch her. No, I didn't pray for her. I would just see her on the floor weeping before God, repenting of past sin. Because you've got to repent to get the past cleaned out. Repenting on the floor. And God was washing her clean over and over and over. And when she went back home, I'm thinking of this because Pastor Chris, her father, is sitting here today. When she went back home, it was Christmas time. And she had to, she just, out of her own heart, stood before her church and repented to her daddy and to the church for living a lie. for continuing in sin and yet naming the name of Christ. Oh, brothers and sisters, God wants to reveal the Lamb in you so that He can reveal the Lamb in the church, and so that through the church He can reveal the Lamb to the earth. But I want to show you something. The soldiers, they were from the temple. They were the temple guards. They came up the Mount of Olives. They enter the garden. What does Peter do? He pulls out his sword and cuts off Malchus's ear, as we just saw in the video. And I'm begging you to hear me, because I say this to every group every year. And I always have some that won't listen. I say this especially to those of you who are younger. I often see people come out of these internships. They're so on fire. They're so full of this message. They feel, but they're letting pride get in. I've got the message now. I've got it. I'm carrying this great message of the Lamb and the cup and the cross. And they let pride come in. So I want to show you this example. Peter pulls out his sword, cuts off Malchus's ear, the high priest's servant. And Jesus says, put away your sword. I'm begging you. Don't go out of here slashing swords. Don't go out of here cutting ears off. That is symbolic. Malchus is part of the religious system. Peter takes it into his own hands. You know, even that little sword is a picture of the cross. So we can relate this to us and say, when we go out, don't slash off ears. Because if you do, they'll never hear you. Ears are for hearing. That is a picture, and I believe, and God just showed me that probably yesterday. If we go out and we're full of zeal and boldness and pride, and we think we've got it, we've got the message, so we're just correcting everybody, we're correcting our own pastors, we're trying to slash that religious system to bits and saying, you know, what we believe is so true. Go with humility. Go with put away your sword. And it's such a challenge. I'm praying, Richard, I'm praying every day, God, show me how to bring this message in love, in a way that people can receive it. It's not easy to bring it in a way that people can receive it, is it, Josh? So we need wisdom. Maybe Pastor Chris can help us in the wisdom class. Wisdom for how to bring this message in a way that will transform hearts and not cut off ears and silence people to the message. Amen. Will you do that, guys, please? I say guys, I mean guys and girls. I mean everybody, men and women. Don't slash off religious ears is the point. Now, just to cap it all, Jesus says to Peter, shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me to drink? Remember, Jonathan Edwards said that his principal errand into the world was to drink that cup. In other words, Peter, this is why I came. This is the most important thing about what I'm getting ready to do. I must drink the Father's cup. And people, you'll hear these arguments. Some will say, oh, remember when Jesus talked to James and John and he said to them, oh, can you drink from my cup? And they said, oh, yes, Lord. And he said, yes, you will drink from my cup. But listen, no man can drink the Father's cup. Jesus drank the Father's cup of eternal wrath. Now, they will drink it in hell, eternally in crime. My God, why have you forsaken me? And they will cry, I thirst. Oh, my goodness. But in the meantime, Jesus is saying, this is why I came, to drink the Father's cup. So you'll have so many arguments that will try to undo the Father's cup. Don't let them do that to you. This is what will help you. Keep going back to the Bible and keep asking God. And when you will notice there is a fire on you. It's been that fire on me. I tried to preach other messages, but I couldn't because I didn't feel the fire. I'm not saying this is the only message, but I am saying it's the central message. All right? And pastors have to give a full diet. That's true. But don't forget the most important point. I came to drink my Father's cup. So again, I want to go back to that point. Jesus said to the disciples, why are you sleeping through the cup? And I believe, I just kept thinking this yesterday when we were at that wonderful church that has the signs all around that said, oh, the Pioneer Awakening. And I wanted to say, if we're going to have an awakening, we need to understand, we need to awaken to what Jesus did on the cross. Because I promise you, I've seen hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people awaken to their calling, to their purpose. You don't have to be 20 years old. I've seen them at 68 years old awaken to their calling when they looked at the Father's cup. So our hearts awaken once we see the Father's cup. I just know that's what happened to me. So I'm going to tell you my story. I kind of told it in that video I showed the other day, but I kind of had the sense in talking to some of you that maybe you didn't quite hear that part. So I want to tell it again. You know, I was a young Bible teacher, about 35 years old, and I was teaching a Life of Christ course and an Old Testament survey course, and I began because my pastor said, why don't you read the great Puritans, and I read Jonathan Edwards, and I was just captivated by Edwards. Even though he's not easy to read, I just kept feeling something in what I was reading that was like nothing I had ever read. The greatest thing I ever read from Jonathan Edwards was called The History of the Work of Redemption. Y'all, you can get this on your Kindle for $1.99. I'm not kidding. And then you can make the print as big as you want it. Because I had to read this teeny tiny little print in his book. But when I came to a sermon called Christ's Agony, that's what changed my life forever. I basically gave you that message today in this class because he was talking about that clotted blood that Jesus sweat when he looked into the Father's cup and saw the furnace of the Father's wrath. So I'm reading all this in Jonathan Edwards, Christ's Agony, the sermon was called. I'm reading it and I can't believe it. I never knew about the Father's cup. It was filling me. It was consuming me and burning me. I'm teaching a Life of Christ course. I can't wait to get to Easter time or the resurrection time where I could tell about the Father's cup, but it's not quite there yet. And I'm visiting a Methodist church. There was a split in my charismatic church. I wasn't the pastor, but the pastor got immoral and all that stuff. And it split. And I was visiting this sweet little Methodist church. Remember, I was telling y'all that the other day. This sweet Methodist church. Everybody there, just salt of the earth people. And I'm in the Sunday school class. And this man says, now remember this question because you're going to be asked this question. He said, and we've got to have an answer. He said, I just don't see what the big deal is about the cross of Jesus. Lots of people have died on crosses and we don't worship them. And that's true. Thousands of Jewish people were crucified in 70 AD. And thousands, millions of martyrs. He said, what's the big deal about the cross? Well, the class started saying things like, and they were good things they were saying. Oh, he suffered so much. He was rejected by his people. He was beaten by that whip, that cat of nine tails. He suffered when the nails, the spikes went into his hands and he became sin and the Father abandoned him. And I am sitting over there as a visitor and I'm like, oh, I'm just swelling. I'm with that, it's like a prophetic word, but just exploding inside of me and I've got to get it out. I've got to tell what is just burning inside of me. And yet I'm trying to be a nice Methodist, you know, this morning and not get too passionate here. And finally, I couldn't contain it any longer. Plus, I'm a visitor. And I said, I know I'm just a visitor, but do you mind if I share a little bit? And I stood up because I couldn't sit. And I just began to pour out. I said, it wasn't just the scourge that ripped his body to bloody shreds. It wasn't just the spikes that wounded those beautiful hands and feet. It wasn't just the fact that sin poured down upon him. It wasn't just the fact that even that the Father abandoned him. It was all of this. But it was so much more. Most of all, brothers and sisters, it was that God opened heaven and he roared down wrath and punishment and judgment down upon the innocent Son of God over and over and over and over again. And Jesus drank down the dregs of the Father's cup. And I mean, I tell you, those people, they were like, we've never heard this before. And they asked me to come back and teach, and I taught for a month in that class. But I'm telling you, it's not that got me. I mean, it's not that they were amazed by the cup. It's what happened to me. My heart was stunned. My heart was amazed. I was never the same. I sat in church that day. I was trembling all over. You know, I see people tremble and fall a lot, but I don't care about their physical trembling. I want to know, does your heart tremble? My heart was trembling. It was bleeding. It was weeping inside. And I'm sitting in this wonderful Methodist church, and I can't hear a word that's being said because I'm thinking, Lord, I don't understand. I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit for, at that point, probably 20 or 30 years. I've been speaking in tongues. I've been saved for at least 30 years. This is something I've never, ever experienced. This is fire. And all of a sudden, I understood what it meant to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and fire. I understood this trembling fire of God. I think that's what it is, a baptism of fire. You know, I wasn't putting everything together yet, but I knew. I was questioning, I thought, because I thought when you got baptized with the Holy Spirit, you got it all. I really did, and I'm sure most of you thought that too. I thought I got it all, but this was different. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm repenting to God. I'm saying, God, I'm so sorry. Father, I'm so sorry. I've taught all these other messages through the years, and I always tried to teach as deep as I could. And you know, because I wanted to impress people, I was full of selfish ambition. And so I'm repenting to God for the selfish ambition and for all the teachings that I'd given. That, I mean, they were good. They were true. They were good. Most of them. Not all of them. But I'm repenting to God and just saying I'm so sorry. But right there in church, I made a commitment to God. I didn't realize that this was what Paul had said. Paul said, I have resolved to know nothing but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. 1 Corinthians 2:2. I've resolved to know nothing but Christ and Him crucified. And right there in church that morning, I resolved. I said, God, for the rest of my life, this is almost 30 years ago. I said, for the rest of my life, I'm going to teach and write and minister and preach on the Father's cup and on the cross of Jesus Christ. I was writing books then, but, you know, they weren't very good. And I said, God, for the rest of my life, I'm going to write books on the cross and on the Father's cup.